Hello, people. I need to play my
music. Hello, can you hear me?
I can, yeah. Hi, Michael. How are you?
I'm good.
Thanks for talking to us, Michael.
You're welcome.
Good, good, good. So, is it okay to say those three things when talking to you, or what?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm way beyond considering that Hubbard is much more than just a con man.
Okay. Well, I don't want to upset any Scientologists that might hear this, so we won't go into that one.
No, that's fine. But yeah, that's fine.
I believe you're some people call it wake up, some people call it breaking the spell, but I believe the moment for you was questions that you had about the announcement of LRH's death, yeah?
Yeah, that was really, a major issue for me, because, you know, at first I actually accepted, because I was at the event where Miscavige spoke. I was in the Palladium that night with my wife, my then wife. And I bought the whole thing, you know. I was upset over his death, and, you know, I figured, well, these guys seem to have a handle on things, and they know what they're doing. And I even got another additional briefing from Jeannie Bogvad,
okay,
who was on a Sea Org mission to run LA Org at the time. And I think with her and her wife, I don't know that he died yet, but she gave some additional, you know, background detail in a little meeting over at LA Org.
Right.
But then in the next few years, you know, some weird things happened, like the cancellation of the Admiral flag order.
Yeah, that was pretty weird. Can I just ask you as well, I think the two main speakers that evening were Pat Broker and David Miscavige. Is that correct?
Well, there was, yes, definitely Pat Broker.
Okay.
And definitely Miscavige.
Right.
But Earl Cooley also spoke.
Yeah, he was the lawyer, wasn't he? Yeah.
Yes, he was the lawyer. Right. He was that slimy lawyer.
Yeah, and that's how he comes across, yeah.
I think also perhaps Ray Midoff spoke.
Yeah. Did you know who they were at that point? Because this is like 1986, isn't it?
Right. Well, I knew who Ray Midoff was.
Okay.
I think Norman Starkey spoke a little bit too.
Yeah.
I think I had heard his name, but I didn't, you know, I didn't know him. I knew who Miscavige was more or less. But he was just a messenger, and I'd actually met him, I believe, when he was, when I was doing the mission stuff, on the renovation of the complex.
Okay, that's interesting.
And I didn't know Pat Broker.
Okay, because that kind of fascinates me a little bit. I actually only got in 1987, so this had already taken place. But I had heard of Norman Starkey and Ray Midoff, and of course David Miscavige was the leader when I came along. But Pat Broker, I'd never heard of until I began to research into the whole thing in 2008. So it's a name that wasn't on everyone's lips, you know. And yet he was the successor, so.
Yeah, that was really interesting.
Yeah.
But, you know, I bought it, and I just, you know, when that was canceled, I started going, okay, how does this person who was so close to Hubbard for so many years suddenly get, you know, depersonalized?
Exactly, exactly.
You know?
So basically, for anybody who doesn't know the story, Pat Broker was left the heir apparent, the heir to the fortune, or whatever you want to call it, in Hubbard's will, which he changed apparently the day before he died. And he announced it at this conference that we're talking about. But then, was it within the week or a few weeks that it was changed and Pat Broker was out ethics and whatever? And
I'm a little vague on that. Mm. I think it was by the end of 1986.
Okay.
But I think it was a few months before I had actually heard about it. And it wasn't broad public issue, I don't think.
No.
So much.
No. Yeah.
You heard about it, but it was kind of like, oh, by the way, you know.
A person that I was talking to about this, and I will not mention this person's name, but they were actually David Miscavige's CS, which is case supervisor. While I had her there, I said, so when did he last have any auditing? And I was told 1994. So in case anybody's wondering, DM last had auditing about 20 years ago. So anyway, I wouldn't like to talk about his case state. But what interested me was that she told me that Pat Broker photographs were given to all Sea Org members for their desks. I don't know if you can remember that. And then, of course, when he was like declared persona non grata, all these photographs had to be destroyed. Did you hear of that, or were you aware of that?
Well, I wasn't in the Sea Org.
Oh, okay.
At that time, I had been in, and actually, it's funny because I had been in the Sea Org in '84.
All right.
And also had been around in PAC, you know, in '81, '82, when all the mission holder crap was going down.
Very quickly,
I was actually Adam.
What happened in the Sea Org? Like, you were in and then you were out. That's unheard of. Tell me more about that.
Oh God, it's, you know, all right. So I got in 75,
right.
Late 75.
Okay.
And I was on staff at San Francisco, and I couldn't handle it. And part of the reason I couldn't handle it is because I didn't feel I was trained to handle it.
Right.
They just, you know, when I joined staff, you know, I had done the HAS course, right? The communication course.
Yes. Yeah.
And I had no other training. So they stuck me on ARC break reg post.
Okay, that's a fairly specialized post.
It is.
Yeah.
And, you know, I had had my ups and downs already before that.
Okay.
You know, and had almost left. But Dennis Fasilla, who had been the ARC break reg and who had come and saw me and recovered me more or less.
Okay.
Recruited me, and so I took over his post so he could do something else.
Wow.
But if you know what an ARC break is, so this was recovering people who had blown the org, who didn't want to do Scientology anymore.
For whatever reason. Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
amazing.
And it was a registrar post because you're supposed to get them back in and sign them up again.
Oh my.
And I just had no clue about all the reasons why people would leave.
Of course, yeah.
And so I just had zero stats, essentially.
Well, I can understand
I'd make all these contacts, and I'd make all these, you know, phone calls, and people would talk to me, you know. And so sometimes my contact statistic would be up, but other times, you know, my actual handled and back in the org statistic.
Oh, God.
Public handle. It was like zero every week, zero, zero, zero. I think I had, and the line for this was I was supposed to contact them.
Yeah.
You know, use the DSM drill, use my TRs, whatever.
Of course, yeah.
Convince them to come back in the org. And the hook was that they would get a free ARC break session to handle their upset.
Right, okay.
Okay, so... And that was per the Hubbard, you know, policy on it, was that it was supposed to be an ARC break assessment so that they could figure out, you know, whether it was something the person had done, whether somebody had done something to them.
Of course, yeah.
You know, the whole bit, right?
Yeah.
So, but the thing is, there was no auditor posted to do that. Okay.
So there you were with the bait trying to get these people in, and if you did, yes, there was nothing for them. Oh my God.
Right.
I know it's
see, other,
it's going back
the
a while.
That was crazy.
Go ahead. Sorry.
Cuz I had to go plead with the DOP, or the director of training, and I forget which one he was. It was Lance. Oh, I forget what his last name is. It'll come to me. My memory is failing.
Okay.
I would have to go to the DOP or the DOT and plead with them to give me an auditor so that when this person came into the org, they didn't have to wait and they didn't have to, sit around and get more upset because nobody was seeing them. And so most of the few times that I got people into the org,
yeah,
there was no auditor to be found. I had huge arguments with the DOT and the DOP.
Oh, my God.
Trying to get, this recovery, this session, right?
Yeah.
And then I think the only person I ever recovered was a person by the name of Bear Bell Mueller.
Whoa. Is that a male or a female?
That's a female.
Okay.
And nice woman, and I, for the life of me, but I remember also getting really, really upset because at least two of the times, and I probably only had three total, at least two of the times that I got people in and actually got them an ARC break session, they came out bad indicators.
This is fantastic stuff. Oh my God. I wanted to ask you before we move on. I know it's like going back a long time, but can you remember any of the replies you got from people that you contacted? Were any like totally outright abusive and nasty to you? Like you got three in, that's great. Yay. But can you remember any of the details of that? Just because it might be funny, that's all,
Well, and this was San Francisco, right? So I used to take, the train and the trolley cars and whatever to go out and see people.
Oh, you had to go and visit them as well, yeah?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
See, that's part of the contact thing, right? Because if you couldn't get a hold of them or talk to them on the phone, you had to go see them.
Oh, no way. Because I thought you just sat there on the phone with a list of names to call.
Because you can't handle somebody over the phone, really.
Actually, you can't. Oh, this gets better. Carry on.
You gotta see them. You gotta see what their indicators are. You gotta see when they go bad indicators.
Of course,
what hits, right? And use your TRs, because they can always hang up on the phone.
Of course, yeah.
But people are a lot more tolerant if you're talking to them, except for a few. Yes, I got screamed at.
Oh, my God.
Most people were actually quite polite.
Okay.
And they would just hold their position, they would just go, no, I'm sorry, I don't want to do that anymore. But no, I'm sorry, I'm not going to do that anymore. And I actually went over to this guy who was living actually quite a ways away in San Francisco and showed up in his neighborhood, and he was working on his front yard. And I talked to him for about half an hour. And I said, when I saw him, I made up this thing. Oh, I was just in the neighborhood, and I saw that you lived here. Such a transparent lie. I was such a newbie.
Oh my God.
Anyway, that lasted for about 6 months or so.
But Michael, let me ask you, if you did get three, let's say, in for the ARC break that was either went well or not or whatever, three, just roughly, I mean, I don't mean exactly, obviously. Was it in the hundreds or what?
That I contacted?
Yeah.
Overall, it probably was in the hundreds.
Wow. And three responded. Do you know something? Even if you'd had training, you'd probably have the same figures.
Well, I was probably one of Dennis Fasella's only stats.
Yeah.
In terms of actually getting people back in. I didn't have any success. And Bridget Kelleher was the ED at that time.
Right, okay.
Who went on to become an infamous, rapacious IAS registrar. Mm. And she would yell at me every week in the staff meetings, because I didn't have any stats.
You personally, she would pick on you?
Yeah, because my stats would be zero, No, nobody recovered. And so you know, they wanted to put me in lower conditions, but then they would do the qual sec, you know, was required to do an evaluation, and they always find out that, well, you know, I'd never done the PTSSP course, you know, I'd never done this, I'd never studied that policy, you know, so I was in cramming all the time. And so eventually I couldn't handle it anymore. I was very sad, and I was subject to depression anyway, but I was extremely sad at not being able to do anything, and all my dreams of helping out Scientology, yeah, and clearing the planet, getting myself up the bridge, were just completely trashed.
Yeah.
And, you know, and so one day I just left.
Okay, so you left staff, but then
I did.
But then someone must have recovered you at some point and got you back in.
Well, I recovered myself. Oh, okay. I knew I couldn't make it as a staff member, but you know, after a few days, you know, I calmed down or whatever, and
yeah,
I, of course, I was living with staff members, so I had to move out.
Ah, right. Okay.
And so after a few days, I went back and I talked, and so they basically had expelled me for blowing staff.
Of course, yeah, usual thing.
And yeah, so I started on ADE.
Uh huh.
And my amends project for ADE was because I knew printing and stuff like that, and I had went and gotten a job and was working in a print shop and stuff like that. I took over the mimeo department.
Okay, with any training?
No, I figured it out. It was not the guy who was there showed me how to run the Gestetten mimeograph machines. And
I was going
to
ask you, was it the old-fashioned mimeograph machine? I was going to ask you that, and then you told me it was. So yeah, excellent. So how come you ended up in the Sea Org, and how come you ended up leaving the Sea Org?
Well, I've been doing amends for quite a while, and I'd gotten up to non-existence.
Woo!
Yeah. I still had a ways to go.
Okay.
So Bob Harvey and Ruthie Silverberg came in on a recruitment mission for Asho Foundation.
Uh-huh.
And I think it was Foundation. Yeah, I think it was Foundation. And they, of course, talked to me because they talked to everybody. And I had heard about the Sea Org, and I had actually wanted to go be in the Photo Shoot Org.
All right.
Which was the precursor to Universal Media Org, which was the precursor to Golden Arrow Studios.
Excellent. Okay.
So this was actually when Hubbard was supposedly still in the Caribbean, I guess, and shooting those pictures for the big volunteer ministers handbook that were used in that book.
Yeah, I remember it. Yeah.
And so people were going who had experience in photography and had lots of experience in photography and printing and stuff. And so I wanted to do that, but they said, oh, no, you have to be trained as an auditor before you can go into the Seward. Well, so that kind of dashed that. And plus I had a contract with the Aura, right? So then yeah, here I was working on my amends doing ADE, and Bob Harvey comes in. And I tell him, look, I'm working on my ADE. And he says, oh, well, you've gotten up to non-existence, right? You know, and I said, yeah. And he said, well, you're good.
Oh, my. Oh.
And so literally, that was like on a Friday. I quit my job by writing a letter to my boss, dropping it through the mail slot or something at the business, packed up my stuff. And on Sunday, we were headed down the coast in the car.
Oh, my God. With
all my stuff, you know.
So
not that heavy.
Wow. So and what were you recruited as? Was it to work in the film unit or?
No, I was recruited to be an auditor.
Okay.
On Asher Foundation staff.
Okay, and did that tally with what you wanted to do as well? Did you want to?
Yeah, I definitely wanted to be an auditor.
Okay.
That was my, you know, that was really what I thought was I wanted to do.
I spoke with Chris and a number of other people who said that they were recruited for one thing and then moved over to somewhere else, which immediately caused an upset because that's not what they wanted to do, you know.
Absolutely. In the Sea Org, once you're in the door, all promises are off. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Because you're the Sea Org property and they put you where they want to.
Yeah, and you can write that down in big capital letters. Big blocks.
Absolutely. And the only way you can get a post then, once you got on a post, the only way you can change posts is if you recruit your replacement.
Yes. Yeah.
So it was basically impossible except for a few individuals to do that. So there's all these people who joined to become auditors or case supervisors or, you know, whatever, who were promised that they would be able to do that. But it was kind of like that underhanded one, you know, yes, you can be an auditor if you spend 20 years doing something else first. You know,
so there's those people collecting plates in the kitchen want to be auditors, really, of course. Yeah.
Right. So really, the only people who really became auditors in the Sea Org right off the bat, except for maybe a very few, were people who already had trained up as a public.
Yeah.
They'd already gotten to class 4, or yeah, they'd already gotten to class 6, or something like that. And they'd already been auditing, like, in an org or something like that. And then they would get recruited. And then sometimes they would get sent to higher level.
Yeah, that breaking promises is so prevalent in the Scientology world. And if you do try to complain to anyone, they turn it on you to say that you're just motivating or whatever, and just get on, you know, just get on
yes,
and do your job.
Motivation, you know? Yes.
Yeah.
You're just motivating. You're just a crim.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you want something for free, and you know, so it was the whole bait and switch thing.
Of course.
Within the Sea Org, it's the bait and switch thing, just as it is with the public.
Yeah.
You know, it's always someone else having control over your decision and over, you know, where you are and where you work and what you eat and where you sleep. And you really, and especially for someone like me who's depressed and introverted, I had a very hard time advocating for myself.
Yeah. The whole betrayal thing is fascinating. When I joined staff, I had an interview with the ED of the org, and I was promised a certain amount of money per week as a minimum, which at the time was £200 English, which would be about, what, $300 for 1987. And of course,
yeah, and you could live on that.
Yeah, that's what I was getting. So all I asked for was similar rates of pay. I don't think I got $300 the entire 3 years I was there. You know.
Oh my God!
But the betrayal was the thing, you know. And a few years later, when I was running a mission, the ED of another org came to me, and we sat down in a park, and you know, people were running by, kids were playing. And he said, so what's your story? What is the problem? And I told him this whole thing, how my entire Scientology life was based on this lie that I was going to get this wage every week, and I was lied to. I took a long time to tell him this, you know, because I told him all the other things that upset me as well. And when I'd finished, he just looked at me and said, that's just one big motivator. Oh, God. And I'm thinking, oh my God, I've just poured my heart out to this guy and he thinks I'm just motivating. I couldn't agree with that. So there was another upset right there, you know, I mean.
Absolutely.
Incredible stuff. I mean, I can see as well how they think they're doing the right thing, but oh my God, you know. Whew. So how did you leave the Sea Org? I'm dying to know.
Well, the first time.
Oh God.
I was in the Sea Org 3 different times, Pete.
Oh, wow. Okay, which is the best one? Yeah.
All right, so the first time, I went down to Los Angeles, went on the EPF.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was at Big Blue for the renovations. I was there. I moved in to the Lebanon Hall probably 3, maybe 4 days after they actually had okay from the permits and city to take possession of the property after escrow had cleared and all that crap.
Wow. Okay.
So then they basically moved all the RPF and all the EPF from around the Los Angeles area into the complex there.
Right.
And went on the EPF. And funny enough, I actually got some auditing when I was on the EPF. And at that time, there was this whole thing that Hubbard had started. I think it came from Hubbard, which was he had done an evaluation, right?
Mm-hmm.
And said that the reason staff were not succeeding is essentially that they were untrained.
Right.
And that they had a culture within their staff that everybody was doing the same thing and everybody was overlooking all the outpoints, right?
Okay.
And so his solution to that for the Sea Org was to get everybody up to product two. Now, I don't know if you know about Sea Org, the product levels, right?
It starts at... Not very much, so enlighten me on that.
Well, you're familiar with staff status zero and staff status one and staff status two,
of
right?
course, yeah. You work your way up.
Okay, well, it kind of follows along with that, but staff status or product zero was basically, you know, do stuff on the decks, and you study, like, if you haven't done the student hat, you do the student hat, you know, if you haven't, you know, had and basic policy and that kind of stuff. The same type of stuff that you do as staff status zero, but added to that was the specialized Sea Org stuff, like you study basic Sea Org flag orders, and you study, you know, the org boards, and you do the welcome to the Sea Org tapes,
uh-huh.
And you do, you know, various other things like that. So you do product zero, right? And product zero was a fairly long lineup. It took most people several months to do.
Wow, okay.
Then you went on product one, and the core of product one was Vol Zero. OEC Vol Zero, the whole thing.
The entire volume, right.
The entire volume, you know, done full student hat, star rate style.
Wow. Okay.
Okay. So, and plus, you know, like personal grooming course and ethics course and, you know, all these other courses, right? And then product two, I never got to product two.
Okay.
I did finish product one pretty much, but I never got to product two.
I can remember when I was at St. Hill in England seeing Sea Org members who had completed a step on this, and they were actually glowing, you know, with pride.
It was a big deal.
Yeah.
It was a big deal. The people who actually got to product two usually took them over a year.
Wow.
On the EPF okay. to do. But the idea was when they would go back to the org, they would be a stable, trained staff member who could resist all the crap that was going on in the org and reform it.
Of course, yeah.
Well, of course, that never worked, right? And, you know, of course, they were RPFing people right and left with the whole List 1 debacle.
Right.
And anyway, and plus the renovations were going on. But along with doing the product levels, we had great food. I mean, we had protein, we had a variety of vegetables, we ate muesli for breakfast, we had raw whole milk.
Yeah.
We had, you know, I mean, we were basically treated very, very well in the early days I was on the EPF.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about that, because certainly when I was at the Big Blue, one of my most fond memories is the food area. I forget what it was called now, but it was this huge dining hall. And there was a Mexican guy on the door, and as you left, he would say, "Vote, senor," and you had to give him votes out of, I think he had one to five, yeah. And he was some character, you know, he wouldn't engage in any conversation whatsoever, just "Vote, senor," and you had to give him a number, which he wrote down. But the food was wonderful. It was absolutely gorgeous stuff. But what was the berthing like? Because I can remember, like, prowling around the Big Blue and looking in various places, and I saw these rooms that were filled with these triple tier bunk beds and the smell. I was horrified looking at them and, you know, thanking my lucky stars that I wasn't in the Sea Org. What was it like in that particular time period?
Well, when I first started, we were in rooms, I think I was sixth floor, Lebanon Hall. And it had been like nurses birthing,
okay.
or something like that. It was a large room. It was, you know, I don't know, 40 feet long or whatever, along one of those walls of Lebanon Hall. It had a number of windows, had two doors, And it was all like linoleum hospital floor and, you know, nice painted walls.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, the bunks were three or four high.
Wow.
And there were a lot of people in there, but it wasn't trashy. It wasn't dirty.
Yeah.
There weren't a lot of bugs, you know? There were a lot of people in that room, but it wasn't like you were sleeping right next to somebody. You know, there was like 4 or 5 feet between the bunks and
okay.
that kind of thing. You know, so it was more like an army barracks kind of setup.
Yeah,
right?
Pretty tough, but tolerable, would you say?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the worst thing you had to worry about was like falling out of your third level bunk or slipping way down.
Yeah.
And I was right near the ceiling, you know. I was like, I had about 2 feet.
Oh, my God, yeah. And was it a mad scramble when it was like shower time? Did everyone have to scramble to get in the showers, or what was the story?
Showers were tricky. You did have to scramble for showers, but you actually had time, you know, before you secured. And it wasn't crazy. We secured at 10 o'clock.
Right.
Right. We were supposed to be in bed at 10 o'clock because we got up at 7, you know, whatever the hell it was for breakfast.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, we had time from when we got off course to either get a shower or, you know, clean up or whatever and all that stuff, right? So, and then you could do it at lunch or whatever, but we were still using all the old showers that were in like the hospital rooms.
Ah, right.
Right. So everybody would fan out throughout like the main building there to all the old hospital rooms that still had working bathrooms and get showers in those. And there were a few standalone showers. And then of course there were the showers in the morgue.
Right.
The showers in the morgue became the girls' showers, I think, for the RPF.
Yeah, I think I remember that, actually. Yeah, I think I remember the morgue.
That's kind of creepy. I didn't see it, but they found a head in one of the lockers.
Oh, go away.
Yep. True.
I don't know why I'm laughing. That's gruesome.
The hospital had forgotten a head.
Oh, my God. How to get a head.
And, you know, and it was, they had just moved all their shit out.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
They had left a tremendous amount of old medical equipment.
Oh, go away.
Because they didn't expect us to, yes, because they didn't expect Scientology to take over on the day escrow closed.
Mm.
They thought they would have, oh, yeah, they're going to demolition it, you know.
Sure, yeah.
And that's
yeah.
how they only paid $5 million for the whole thing.
Yeah.
And it was sold, I'm sure, because Scientology represented to them, oh, these are old buildings, we're going to have to demolish them, you know, da, da, da. And so they got fire sale prices off of it, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Because that would be a huge project. So then, the day escrow closed, they moved in with all these CEORG members, and the hospital couldn't get anything more out. There was hyperbaric chambers, there was a 4-pound jar of cocaine still in the pharmacy,
oh,
there were pills
whoa.
All over the There was pills all over the place. There was, you know, electronic medical sensors and stuff like that. There was one guy who spent like the next 2 years selling that stuff to individual, you know, clinics and stuff who needed medical equipment on the cheap.
Wow.
And he made hundreds of thousands of dollars doing that for the church. So, yeah, it was really crazy. So where were we at?
I don't know, but I'm tempted to ask where the
okay.
Any,
so showers. So anyway, we got showers. However, we could get them. It really didn't seem to be a problem. And then, when we got, and then there was a special shower down in the old radiation laboratory, where they gave people, you know, radiation treatments and stuff. That there was an office down there that had a private shower in it. That not too many folks knew about. And so I could almost always get into that shower whenever I wanted.
Yeah. I think there was a lot of enterprise, I think, in the situation, wasn't there? Like if you found some way of doing something that made life easier, then you could get along and do that.
Yeah, and it wasn't so strictly controlled. And I could, you know, I could always, like, get out.
Yeah.
Of the complex, yeah. I needed to go for the walk.
I wanted to ask you, did they leave any ECT machines behind?
Not that I know of. They might have.
That would...
Because what is now LA Org was the psych building.
Oh, wow.
And they actually had isolation rooms with restraints and all that stuff. And they had testing labs with double glass, you know, for silence.
Oh, wow. And, scary.
Yeah, so it was there's some pretty crazy stuff. So anyway, all that went on, and actually the first part of my APF experience was pretty good. But they had mistimed all the renovations. They thought it would happen much faster.
Ah.
And I started to get really depressed, and so I was let go from the mission that I was on, which was Mission Science Exterior. But I was still working for the Pack Move guys.
Right.
So I didn't go to ASHO, where my post would be. And they made me a plumber, so I started doing plumbing.
You're now a plumber.
Exactly, you know, and trying to get inspections, you know, on my plumbing and stuff, which was pretty good, except I didn't know a whole lot. And so, you know, there were times I had to rip stuff out and redo because the inspector said, "What in the hell are you doing?" and no supervision really.
No.
But so they got through the initial renovations of LA Org, and that was pretty much a success and pretty much on time, a few months late. They got ASHO partway done.
Yeah, because ASHO was the building opposite, wasn't it, as I recall?
No, ASHO was the one that links with LA Org. It's the one along L. Ron Hubbard Way, the long one.
Oh, yeah. And do you go up steps to get to that? Is that the one with...
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I do.
Yes, the steps with the stupid lion out front.
Yeah, and the one opposite, what was that then? Was that...
That was AOLA.
Ah, yes, of course. Yeah, yeah.
And that was kind of the breaking point for me, because I was, again, depressed. I was unhappy. I had been moved into crappy birthing, you know, so I didn't, you know, it wasn't good birthing.
Mm.
It was just some hole with somebody else, you know, who was doing boiler stuff, you know. It was all right. But then they were going to move me in another one of these really crappy birthing situations, so I didn't like that. The food had gotten worse, although that wasn't particularly a factor. But they started to renovate AOLA. They finally realized they needed to renovate that four-story building.
Yeah.
It's a U-shaped building,
mm-hmm.
built during the World War II. And so they really needed to tear everything out. I mean, completely demolish the interior and replumb it, re-electrify it, the whole bit. So... the thing was is that the existing advanced organization over on Temple Street had already put in their order for the change of phones.
Right.
Which meant that at some hard date, the phone company was going to take away the phones over at AOLA and hook them up to the new building. And they couldn't change that. And they couldn't just get new phones at the new building because they had to keep the phone numbers. That was LRH policy. So... that was going to happen. So, like, 49 days before the phones were going to be switched, they finally realized they were going to have to renovate AOLA.
Oh, my God.
So they pulled everybody on the EPF and everybody on the RPF, and they started renovating that four-story building. It's a U-shaped building. It's like a cube with an atrium in the middle.
Yeah, I think I saw the reception area, but that's about all.
Right, right. And they had turned that middle part into a reception atrium, I think.
Mm.
Anyway, so they had 49 days to do it. And they started out, pretty much canceled everybody's study. And then they started, you know, doing that. And then they realized that they were really behind. And they were still demolishing things. And they were still trying to put up the new studs and all that stuff. So they decided that they were going to do, I think it was about 5 weeks before the cutoff date. And they started to do 30 hours on and 3 hours off.
Yeah, I was going to ask you what the schedule was, but yeah, you've answered that. Go ahead. Sorry. Yeah.
And so that basically means that all those RPFers and all those EPFers who were doing that were working for 30 hours straight. They'd get 3 hours to collapse wherever they were. And then they work another 30 hours, and that just went on and on and on. And so I had finished some of the plumbing jobs in other buildings, and they told me, well, you're going to go on the decks over at AO, and you're going to work the 30 hours on and 3 hours off schedule.
Whoa.
And I said, no, that's insane. I'm not going to do that.
How did that go down?
It didn't go down very well.
Hmm.
And they said, yes, you are. And they said, no, I'm not going to do that. I want to route out. And so then I think that was the time it was. It was Gorman. Randy Gorman was like the ethics officer for estates.
Uh-huh.
And so he pulled me into a room with a couple other big guys. And they were going to impress on me that I was going to stay in the Sea Org and I was going to do this. And they started to close the door. And I said, you close that door and it's kidnapping.
Excellent.
And they left the door open. And I said, I'm leaving. You know, you can give me, you know, the leaving sec check. You can do all that stuff that you think you need to do. But I'm out of here in 3 days.
Right.
You know, I'm gone. I am not going to stay in the Sea Org, and I'm going to be gone whether you think it's okay or not.
And going back to that moment, were you a little afraid, or were you just intent on asserting your rights, or what was going on with you at that time?
I wasn't afraid because they didn't close the door.
Right.
I wasn't afraid that I'd get beat up. I was afraid I'd get locked up.
Right, but
because I had seen like the cage in the basement,
uh-huh,
in the tunnels that they used to have the RPF in, and those guys were locked into a cyclone fence cage in the basement.
Yeah, I think I've heard of this, but actually hearing it again, my mouth is wide open in aghast, really. Please, don't let me stop you. Carry on. They're in a cage. They're locked in a cage. Oh, God.
And they, you know, they were let out to, you know, do things like work.
Yeah.
Right?
So in the back of your mind, there must have been a kind of fear that maybe something bad could happen to you.
Yes. Mm. Yes. And one of the things is that I wasn't treated very well when I was growing up.
Okay.
I was basically treated like a slave, although sort of a, you know, my parents provided the material things, right?
Uh-huh.
But they were emotionally abusive. And I never got anything like an allowance. I never had time to make friends or, you know, be on my own, you know, and really become socialized, right? So I felt like I had been a slave, and I had been ordered around and told what to do my whole fucking life. And there was just something that tripped, and I said, no.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like. That's what it sounds like to me, that something tripped, as you say, and there you are in this room. Do not close that door, you know. God,
yeah.
That would make a great scene in a movie. You know, it would.
You know. So, and so I had some friends who had already left the Sea Org,
uh-huh,
and they gave me a place to live.
Okay.
You know, they let me, you know, camp on their couch, or they actually let me camp in their garage for a while. And they had, you know, a business that they were working for with other Scientologists. And I still consider myself a Scientologist, but I just knew I couldn't stand the Sea Org.
Yeah.
So I worked. Let's see, that was 79, 78. I was 78 when that happened. So I went and stayed with him for a while, and then I decided to go visit my family and stuff like that. So I hitchhiked from Los Angeles to Portland, visited my sister there, and I also visited my sister in Redding.
Mm-hmm.
And then I hitchhiked all my way up to Omak, Washington, which was northern central Washington, about 30 miles from the Canadian border. And that was a story, too. I got a ride with some drunken Indians, which is a complete stereotype, but that's what they were. I mean, they stopped at every bar in every tiny town we went.
No way.
Oh, God. Yeah, that was scary. Anyway, so, and I got some money doing some stuff for my parents, which was like the only time I ever got paid by them for doing anything in my life.
Wow.
And then I hitchhiked back, you know, and I went to Idaho, and I got a job in Idaho, and I worked in Idaho for, I don't know, 9 months or something. And then I got fired. And then right about that time, a few months before that, my case supervisor, when I had been in the Sea Org, she was the case supervisor for estates, and her name was Paige Becker.
Mm-hmm.
She had been married to Howard Becker. And then she married a guy who was on the EPF who was named Richard Kuhn, so her name became Paige Kuhn. And she was like a class 4, class 5 CS.
Mm-hmm.
And auditor, really, really nice woman. And I got along really well with her. And during that time, the whole Dianetics Clear bulletin from Hubbard came out. So she started looking through the folders of people who had left the EPF, who had left the Sea Org. And I had had a pretty good rapport with them. So she like mailed me or called me or something when I was in Idaho, because I had communicated to them about some things or something about me owing them money.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Surprise, surprise.
If you make a mistake when you purchase materials and the materials can't be used, then you owe for those materials.
How does that work?
It doesn't work. It doesn't work anywhere in the log world.
Mm.
If you're working for a business and you make a mistake, the company pays for it. Now, you might get fired for doing it, but you don't have to reimburse them.
No.
Right?
No.
But the Sea Org wanted their $258 for the sheet metal that I ordered while I was working on the sign project that turned out not to be the proper item.
Oh. You know? Okay.
So, because it was for signs and it was galvanized and it wasn't supposed to be galvanized because galvanized doesn't hold on to paint very well. But I didn't know that because I was ignorant.
You were not trained.
Right. You know, I didn't know about that. So anyway, they wanted their $258. So that's why the back and forth had happened. So anyway, Paige called me and said, well, I've been looking through your folders and it looks like you might be clear from some of the things that you said when you were in sessions, you know. Because I had gotten some auditing while I was in the Sea Org.
Yeah, yeah.
Mostly because they were trying to handle some upsets and stuff I had had. And some PTSness and conflict with my parents and shit.
So she was suggesting that you were past life clear? Is that it? Or
yes.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yes,
that I had uttered the clear cognition somewhere in my folders. And she didn't tell me what it was.
Of course not. Yeah, but
So basically, I got fired from my job. Some crazy business there. And so then I hitchhiked back down to California.
Yeah.
And showed up there again. And she gave me a session. And they gave me it was a clear interview back then. And they verified that I was a past life clear.
Excellent.
And yeah. And so then I rejoined the Sea Org.
Woohoo! Technical question. Did you have to re-sign the billion-year contract, or did they just show you your old one?
No, I think I had to re-sign, but they also had to give me a fitness board.
Oh, right.
Because I'd left.
Of course,
And so finally they were convinced that I was okay to come back.
That is brilliant. Michael, I don't want to stop talking to you because this is absolutely fascinating. I love hearing this. I love hearing all stories, but this is particularly fascinating. However, we've been talking for about 50 minutes now. I don't know if you realize that. And
yeah.
I want to I want to call a break at this point. And what we'll do is we'll pick it up at some other point, if that's okay with you.
That's great.
Because I don't want to end up with like some marathon thing that no one's capable of listening to, do you know?
And there's lots that you can cut out in there, you know, besides.
I don't want to. I want to leave it in because I kind of prefer the no editing approach. And if it works, it works. When I've tried to edit, in the past, I've been left with stuff that doesn't make any sense. So I'd much prefer to let it run as a whole piece. And if someone's doing something, they can put it on and listen to it like you listen to the radio, you know. So, I mean, you know, if someone's got a spare 50 minutes or something. So we'll call that part one, if you're okay with that. And the next time we do this, we'll call it part two. And thank you for talking to me, Michael.
Thank you, Pete.
You're welcome.
Thanks for all your good work.
No, you.
I know you put a lot of energy and passion into what you're doing.
Well, I can say quite sincerely. I can say quite sincerely, it's a pleasure.
Yes.
Thanks, Michael.
You know,
oh, sorry. Go on.
You're finally helping people, you know?
Yeah, totally. I'm doing exactly what I wanted to do when I was in Scientology.
Exactly. Exactly. It's same thing for me.
Okay.
All right, bye.
See you, Michael. Bye.